Okay, I think we can start with a bit of a delay. Sorry for that. As you can see, today is like a multiple technological hyper experiment that's going on of me working with two screens at the same time. I hope that the subtitles work. I can't speak any Catalan, which I'm sorry for, so the entire presentation will be in English. We will then go over to a second part of the presentation in which Ines Barreras, a local performance and fashion director, will work with a couple of performers within the pavilion itself. Does this work with the wind and everything? Do you hear me well? Okay, fantastic. Also to everyone, if you want to chill out and just come a bit closer, it's super weird for me to have you like 5 kilometers away, you know? feel free to come over here. So let me check if this works. I need this a bit closer. Okay. Let's try this out. Bruno Mars talking with this in my... Okay, so welcome everybody. I'm super happy and honored to speak tonight in front of an audience that I basically, frankly, know, just as you guys probably also don't know who I am. So actually, we in the studio thought it would therefore be a good exercise to try out to introduce the work that we do properly, as these events don't come up that often. I'm an architect and designer who constructed the installation Free Air that you can see to your right side. I was trained as an architect in the US, United Kingdom, Germany and Belgium, and I work at the Architectural Association in London as a teacher, such as the University of Wuppertal in Germany, and also have an architectural practice in Cologne. So, this slide is pretty much, I hope you can read something, if not I will read it out. This slide is pretty much an inaugural moment for the studio as we try to somehow figure out how we actually work and try to work methodologically over the last couple of projects. And of course, this diagram originally derives from the shape of Rosalind Krauss' essay, Sculpture in the Extended Field. But we have found it quite useful to actually pin down our own methodologies through it. Is it too loud? No? I can see faces do like every time to a peace sound. So let's see how this goes. At the center of every project, you will find this core obsession of the fascination about the gaze. So how can one use space in order to make things visible or invisible is pretty much something that we have been interested in since the very beginning. There are four intrinsic push and pull factors that derive directly from there, in which everything that we do tries to be within these tension fields of these words that you can see on the surrounding: risk, comfort, exposure, and intimacy, which ultimately leads to the fact that we engage more into the subject of trying to problematize question within architecture than finding solutions, I would say. This attitude is carried by four main columns: architecture, design, contemporary culture, and research, which clarify the main scope and intention behind every project. And then potentially a bit hard to read from so far away, you can find these smaller words to the top. And they say performance, scenography, nature, and technology. For us, these are four troops almost, just coming out of more fast tempo environments. And we try to embed them within architecture because it's a very slow profession. And with these entanglements between architecture and different fields of performance and scenography, we try to be a bit more closer to the current states than trying to run through the ultimate long and extended versions that architecture has to run through. Trying to make proof of this diagram, I will present today four different projects. Crystal 2100, Warm, and Free Air. Free Air is the pavilion over there, so in the very end we will get to it. Three projects are concluded, 1, 2, 3. And the fourth one basically exists as an experiment until the 30th of this month. each of the four projects can be understood as a troop that I wanted to use in order to make up for a total. The first project is used to portray the research methodology that we try to carry out. The second project is used to internalize the gaze, so whatever we see. The third project is used to expand the gaze. And the last one, dedicated to performative infrastructure and gazing machines, is about Free Air, the installation for Model Barcelona. Okay, we start with the project named Cristal, starting with this on methodology. The first project, which is a research by design project, was a study that was developed between 2020 and 2001. I think it's important to mention that because it's kind of like the part of the pandemic. So lots of the things that you will see kind of come also out of this fact of being in this state of, let's say, extra conditions. Cristal is in part still going on today. It is a research about the domestication of water. A research on water and architecture in relation to new domestic housing typologies. Cristal investigates into the historical evolution of the bathroom within the global north as a built repercussion of body culture through a series of case studies which reveal its spatial and social implications in search of new living models today. I will present this work via two mediums. First, through the book that we are currently finalizing together with Elsa, through which I will flicker as a work in progress document. And secondly, through its architecture. I will use the book formats in order to give an insight into the methodology with which we have worked, our aims and objectives regarding the research itself, and further on through a series of case studies that have been analyzed, which form a grand narrative that synthesizes the research into a product of design. Before I conclude the presentation, I will try to switch over into this design aspect of the practice. So it's one project that shows at the same time how we try to work theoretically, but it also tries to have speculative design aspects embedded within the presentation. Productive narcissism, seduction machines, and intimate aliens are the names of three different chapters within the book. These are basically stages for three explicit research paths that relate water through a reading of self-design infrastructure and domestic living models to the restroom by pairing contemporary readings of pop cultural media with archival conduct of historic case studies. For today, I will take one out of each the four case studies from each chapter in order to introduce you into the theoretical framework. Chapter 1, Productive Narcissism, portrays the bathroom as a stage through which the human constructs on, further on, fetishizes the civic self and declares the bathroom of the global north as a liminal space which only finds its importance through the sign values of objects that it is adjacent with. It crosses Baudrillard's system of objects and translocates this reading to the morning routine of Patrick Bateman within the movie American Psycho, in which characters are described through objects that they own. From here, Baudrillard's sign values further on to interrogate into the spatial repercussion of the bourgeoisie figure and is further on explored by putting into question what the modern narcissus could consist of when finding its reflection within a mirror image of a pool of water, more precisely by understanding water as an object of the self. The Perroquier, which lived off into the Seine in Paris for the first time in 1761, allowed the bourgeoisie to get privately into contact with water in order to wash off their bodies by heating it in a kettle before it was detached, filled with bodily liquids back into the river. The circulation pattern of the bathing boat is organized according to sex, by two landings, A and B, through which the user could enter the male or female part of the bathing boat. The chapter further continues by giving resolution to the architectures of bodily shame through a parallel reading of the invention of the bathing suit and its dockland water yachts, rendering the naked body as an obscenity. This was later undermined by Victorian bathing etiquette, such as the bathing machines of the 18th century, understood as a unit, and basically this genital-based urbanism that derived from it if you look at the coastline of Borkum. The chapter finds its conclusion by reflecting on the boat, the dockland, and the bathing machine three infrastructures which mediate the soft human body through architecture and its wider territory, by using Berlin and Brandenburg as a stage to introduce four distinct architectural types. Crystal 1 and 2 are part of a network of architectures which are placed around the orbital highway which connects... One second, please. It's pretty difficult to do this double thing. And speak. You know? Alright. Which connects Berlin to its wider territory, Brandenburg, and uses their appearance as last islands of communal restroom culture in service of 350,000 daily commuters through a car wash and a highway shower for truckers in search of a more reciprocal relationship between the outside and the inside through performative infrastructures, aiming for a transparency which connects the interior to its underlying metrics. Act 2, Seduction Machines. The second act further expands the domestication of water. Merci beaucoup. The second act further expands this domestication of water by questioning the way in which society constructed water into good and bad nature. Moreover, good and bad water accelerated the gender distinction in relation to its use. We can find as portrayed to the left side men which started to drain the Brandenburg wetlands, built dams or hydro infrastructures dressed as Friedrich the Great, and tamed so-called wild bad nature outside of the house, while the then purified mastered socio-natural product of domesticated water enters into the household. Here the gender-related domestic labor of maintaining the house became part of the woman. Act 2 therefore questions the lack of visibility of hydro infrastructures today, which mediate between the wild and the tamed, the supposedly natural and the supposedly domestic, and is in search for hybrid monuments which break this binary distinction. Architectural machines. The first public bath within Germany launched in Hamburg in the year 1855 at the Schweinemarkt, an old workers' district. The circular bathing facility found its protocols of gender-related circulation through its cardinal directions, in which women entered through the south while men entered through the north. Only the women bath was allowed to navigate directly towards the center of the circular type, in which devices for childcare, manual laundry washing, and 28 bathtubs could be found. The male section was distinguished in class 1 tubs out of steel and class 2 tubs out of iron. Moreover, the building itself used evaporating states of water from liquid to steam in order to use its metabolism for cleaning purposes. The two following subchapters of the book explore the domestication of water through the arts and define the bathroom as a conceptual product of exhibitions. Moreover, the historic case studies support this domestication through an ever-continuing mass production process. Sanitary devices, as you can see them here, by Dr. Lassa's Volksbrause, which were introduced at the first time during an exhibition format. So basically like Model trying to do extreme architectures installations, one can say a bathroom basically is the same product of daring technology in combination with new cultural shifts. Moving forward into sanitary fetishism and Adolf Loos's obsession in regard of the new emerging figure of the plumber, which created four new prosthetics that entered the household, the tap, the toilet, the shower, and the tub, which started to enter the German households, but had no functional room such as the bathroom to be adjacent to. Towards Crystal 3, a eulogy to the water treatment plant. Okay, now it's in sync again. Recapturing the core questions of the mediation between the nature and the domestic design, the second design, Crystal 3, declares the water treatment plants as a failed opportunity to give due emphasis to domestic architectures and their machining hinterland in order to deconstruct its artificial metabolism. Public water, Crystal 3. Crystal 3 is a water treatment plant placed in the Oderbruch region. Its performative and open structure contrasts the military surveillance mechanisms through which these structures are normally secured. with the plants, I try to work on the subject of trying to expose these infrastructures that are normally hidden to the outside. While these hidden ducts are only accessible for one person, the Hausmeister, meaning the janitor. The janitor's chamber is attached to the treatment plants and further on accelerates the relation between nature and self-defined culture, spatially manifested by carving the slab into four rocks. Digged out of desertificated land, the janitor chamber becomes a canvas for new modes of spatial occupation. Last but not least, act number three, Intimate Strangers. The final chapter introduces the reader into the slow emergence of the functional plan, which 95% of all Germans occupy today. The former four prosthetics, tap top, shower and toilet, started to enter the Berlin courtyard type household before being confined by a functional dictate. The wet room allowed to change function over time due to the placement of light objects, but forecasted the penetration of the bathroom into the private realm. Progressing from the bathroom of the German Empire to the Third Reich, the Reichsbautypus, which derived from Neufahrt's and Speer's housing strategy for Berlin. Casted, which is a project that basically not only casted the start of standardizing architecture, but also, and more importantly, standardizing human bodies, which were using these spaces in the first place. Domesticating desires. Before going one time into the depth of one of the designs, the last case study is the bathroom of the GDR. The WBS-70 Plattenbau type is predicative for the genealogy. It shows a completely internalized bath. No windows for ventilation, hidden ducts, vents and access points, and ultimately forced machines to take over all functions and created its well-tempered environment in the first place, from the isolation to its ventilation to its contained body, with all machines are, while all machines are censored underground and behind walls. A eulogy to hedonism, Crystal 4. Crystal 4 is the last architectural proposition of, let's say, the first project, which I will take into more depth. The building is placed next to the Spree in Berlin. It neglects any form of site specificity deriving from its architectural representation, but is dependent from its direct natural conditions, such as the river water and its cardinal directions, in which its spatial layout plays out at its best with the east-west orientation. The slab type is constructed by a 7x7 column grid and cantilevers 2 meters towards the facade. The program is divided into three spatial figures and resembles an urban hybrid for dense city structures. Floor 1 to 3 hosts a public bath before entering a convoluted mixture of plan 1, which offers 40 square meter apartments, and plan 2, which offers 20 square meter cells. The building reverse engineers the question of censorship and architectural neglect, in which the visitor of the bath enters the building through the boiler room, while residents can reach the upper levels via staircases and elevators. The entrance is planned as an open lobby in which gatherings can take place among the machines that serve the bath and residential levels above. The spatial configuration is used to intensify the dramaturgy of rituals from arrival to undressing to locking up one's clothes until stopping in an intermediate space in which bathing slippers can be found to the sides, while its center offers a drinking fountain. The politics of the interior resolve from the belief that architecture's only goal is to challenge perceptions of comfort and destroy frameworks of constitutive, normative, habitual relations between occupant and spatial provision. Building and occupant enter into a reciprocal performative relation. Double-sized glazed bricks are used to de-censor the idea of a wall. Pipes, ducts, and air vents are manifested as spatial elements. Progressing further, four baths are programmed behind each other, which results from the Japanese Saito culture, in which the body is cleansed individually before entering shared waters. The water track towards the east can be interlocked. And here we basically then started to go over to these more organic shaped ponds, which were sledgehammered out of these tiled floorings. The facade allows to be opened up completely within the summer period while encapsulating its climate during the winter time. It does not serve any further programmatic means within this part. and is meant to accelerate and rejuvenate time in relation to occupation. Looking at an extract of a section reveals how the dramaturgy that is searched for on a horizontal surface is further defined in its verticality. Material conditions drawn in scale 1 to 5 give information on finishings, ductings, and structure. The Saito bath on the ground floor is separated from each other by glazed bricks, while sliding walls allow it to be interconnected with the next door neighbors. To increase lights, a double glazed brick flooring is spanned vertically between 2 IPE beams. Sandwiched into the flanges of the steel structure. The normative top-down gaze. Ah, it's not moving. Well, I think I will skip that slide because it didn't work with the extra effect. Sad. Basically, if you would see this screen, it's moving, but here somehow it doesn't. Was this the same case for the other slides too? That it was just frozen? Or? We have to wait a second because it just plays a video now. Okay. We are now looking at an extract of floor plan 1 in which the 20 square meter apartments are placed. On the residential floor, the outer facade of the building is meant to resemble the porosity that is not exclusive to one's skin. Water taps can be found adjacent towards the molding of the facades that allow gray water, which comes from the gutter, to be used throughout the entire building. The apartments are part of a thermodynamic system in which floor heating is activated due to occupation of the bath and uses the waste heat residue in order to temper certain parts of the apartment through these PVC curtains. The heat within these zones is conceived while all furnishings and objects stand on wheels and therefore allow a multi-flexible layout and basically allow people to domesticate the space as they actually want to. I think there are like some technical difficulties because Okay, I'm sorry for this. I will skip a big part of the presentation to actually get rid of these animated plans, which didn't seem to come out well. Rather than censoring kitchen, bathroom, living room, and bedroom through walls, 4 plateaus on different heights mark zones that can be occupied in multiple ways throughout time due to light objects. 2 fresh water pipes accelerate the spatial flexibility by not screwing a tap into a wall, but by extending a pipe via a water hose, which can serve its function where needed into the room. The spatial manifestation enforces a constant renegotiation between spatial need and temporal desire. To conclude, in project one, the occupant decides what to see and what not. 4 aluminium pipes form a continuous sculpture, interconnecting all rooms in which there is neither an inside nor an outside. Project number 2, name 2100. Same problem. The videos ain't playing. Okay, basically, what you would have seen now is a bunch of projects which all work through video. Apparently, video doesn't work within this presentation format, so I will just talk about what you would have seen, and you have to use your imagination in order to, you know, see the rest. In the beginning of last year, I was approached by a young musician and performer from Cologne, and she explained to me that she saw a certain design that I've made and felt a connection, like, let's say, on the sonic experience that she would try to portray with the songs that she was doing. And basically what happened then is a conversation in which exactly these primary obsessions in regards of intimacy, exposure, dissolvement, the sharpness of the design in relation to the sharpness of the human body were in its center. Damn, so sad. And the beauty of this project, what you could see here now is like a bunch of reflections, cameras moving, performers walk around and dance within this place. It was really that I found myself in our studio listening to music while building these spaces in 3D, which is something that I would always do, but this time actually listening to the lyrics, it had a complete different aspect to it. So it is completely constructed out of aluminium sheets and polycarbonate, and here you can see how the form was actually shaped. We knew that she will give a release concert and a performance within a gallery in Cologne. So what I proposed was that rather than having, you know, these two classical formats of a stage, one is this, one speaks in front, a bunch of people look at each other's back of the heads and partially see me. The other one is a bit more dramatic and has a performer in its center with a bunch of people surrounding him towards the side. We thought like, okay, what if we just don't use either of one of those, but actually reverse the gaze of the typical performer audience layout by allowing the performer to expose, hide, and circulate while capturing the audience in its center. So initially it was constructed as this built-in device which played within the condition of the gallery, having these two very voyeuristic, almost shopping mall-like windows to the front in which suddenly multiple power relations are at place. People from the outside seeing things that the audience inside can't see, the performer playing with that element and movement. Such as a different idea, again, these are now videos which sadly I have to skip. Project number three, Warm. More videos. Imagine this is a dark German forest. It was super cold in December, and drone footage in which basically you now see on top of the forest is lights. The drone falls down towards the ground and shows a design that we have done. It was the first project that we did within the outside place. It sits in the forest of Burghölzhof, which is part of the German center of literature. This was the main condition that produced the project Warm. Again, a close dialogue between architecture and performance. And Warm is a bizarre project because, you know, the other day in the studio we tried to do this exercise to figure out what is the smallest project that we have ever done and what is the biggest project that we have ever done in terms of footsteps. And, like, Warm is super bizarre because it is the smallest one and the biggest one at the same time. It's basically only like 3.5 meter on 3.5 meter wide, but it radiates through lights and basically makes a complete forest that is actually dark, super bright during night. So the way that it looked like, and now you can also not see this, is a performer who would now sing something towards you, but also the music is not playing, so this also doesn't work. And it should portray the performer through this almost perfect fountain of youth through these light dynamics. It creates this light sphere that actually mediates between the darkness and notion of shadows, in which the audience found its position right at the brink of the estimated 5 meter distance due to 4,500 Kelvin colorful lights, which would be then the easiest to digest for your eyes, while the audience had to get to the concert by just seeing this, Warm in its center and a light sphere taking up the entire forest, resting on four clear-coated rocks, and mediating between what can be seen and what not. Oh wow, one image that works. Coming to the final project, Free Air. The pavilion that you can see to your right. Free Air is, of course, in contrast to all the projects that you have seen before, a project that is not finished. So basically, all these, you know, plans and images that I will show now are super work in progress. And before we get into it, I mean, this also doesn't work. Well, before we get into it, I actually wanted to thank the model team. If this would have worked, you would have seen your names, and I wanted to thank, you know, Saul, Eva, Ty, for actually giving me the chance to do this installation. I wanted to thank the technical team, which I enjoyed working with, except for not being able to play the videos, which kind of sucks. But basically, Free Air is a public gathering machine that devotes its space to the element that connects cosmic dust with the lungs that we carry within our body, air. Designed as a performative infrastructure, Free Air contributes to Barcelona's environment through its reflective surface, which harvests NO2 from the air. The installation focuses on the invisible qualities of air by helping us to see, contemplate, measure, and understand the natural resource, which, due to the amount of man-made pollution, is threatening the health condition of all citizens alike. Free Air, which, due to its photocatalytic coating, purifies and improves the condition of air wherever it is placed, creates a meeting point for our current generation and the generations to come. The pavilion is conceived as a research by design project and unfolds its means through various material strategies. And I would like to take a second to actually show you how this works. Again, this would have been an animated plan in which I would have zoomed into different detail points, which is not possible. But I could, you know, talk about its aesthetics, appearance, and references until tomorrow morning. But the installation itself is not so much about like how it looks or what sign value metaphors it plays on, but more about what it actually does. Okay, again a video that... one second, because the video has to play through now. Okay, the form conceived by the pavilion is a result of achieving as much surface area as possible. Surface area in this case means amount of purified air, which I will get to in a second. Push and pull factors on the technical specs of this project were the following. Of course, there's a dynamic surface, which had to be balanced with the wind loads that we have on Plaza Coderc. So dynamic wind loads versus diagonal textile structure. This thing is basically a mid-scale sailing boat and therefore had to be fine-tuned structurally. Load-bearing capacities. If there would have been a better screen, one would see that actually this is a drawing which shows all the, like per each square feet meter that you would have here, you can only use 250 kilograms of pressure on top of it. And the reason for that is that basically this is the roof of parts of the design museum. So we also had to think about like how much weight can we actually construct in order to come up with an installation like this. Another claim that you probably have seen before is the following. Free Air is a prototype infrastructure that cleans air to the equivalent of taking 80 cars off the streets of Barcelona during the time period of Model. So, as mentioned before, all variables have been taken into account to produce the largest surface area as possible, constructed out of this silver shading net. This was important as all textiles have been coated with nanoparticles on the basis of titanium dioxide, TiO2, which reacts photocatalytically. That means that through the exposure of the coated textiles towards lights, a chemical process is set into motion in which the particular matter of air and water is split from each other within the process of transformation. Last but not least, tying the question of in-between generations together with the three primary design strategies stated in the beginning of the presentation, lightness, consistency, and performativity. The entire installation is constructed out of F30 Global Truss systems, which due to lightness not only allow to perform well due to the explained restraintments, but also allowed for a very quick assembly process. So it's scalable, rented, cheap, light, quick, constructed, open source solution, which makes these typical theater structures to the epitome when trying to interlock space with parts of the sharing economy. Interested in consistency, you can find these benches to the right. They basically come out of this fascination to try to work with the same scalable solutions, each one of the 12 pillows, I mean, you have eight over there, some over here, they're basically blown up in different neighborhood districts within Barcelona. So we went with each of the pillows to one district, for example, to Sants or to Ciudad Meridiano or Nou Barris, sorry for my pronunciation, but like basically the air is pumped up within these districts. Then it was quantified and measured, where you can see these stickers to the left on, and it says either like medium, moderate, high, or low on top of them, depending on the air quality that it actually has. The idea behind that was that we wanted to create a cross-section of all the air in Barcelona and bring it back towards the pavilion, in which you can also find several gadgets that actually work on this topic of air. I will skip a couple of slides. Basically, these go further into technicalities that are also animated, which doesn't work. But I think one of the questions that I got the most in the last days was like, what is this weird thing hanging in the back of the installation? Like, what is this? Yesterday, kids were playing with it, throwing a ball from here, like to catch it underneath. But initially, it was thought of as a water collecting device. So apparently tomorrow there might be rain. And the idea was to use this in order to have a bevel underneath that would collect all the water. To conclude and to finish the presentation, Free Air has been the first project of our studio in which we worked with a natural element as a performative tool. We have learned that our preoccupation with performative infrastructures can find appropriate means even when installed temporarily. We also have learned to critically reflect on our own means of how to engage into the conversation of climate crisis and emergencies, be that air, water, earth, or any natural resource, in which we hope that this prototype could be seen as one of several possibilities on how to proliferate the idea, designing from nanoparticles to bodies to objects, furnitures, architectures, and ultimately to the formalization of cultures and audiences who embrace these conditions. At the same time, let's also like put the finger on the target. I mean, we are talking about cars, big ass industries, and like lots of different parts of our society and daily habits that we all just do that basically produce harmless pollutants, right? And it's not solved by silver textiles. This is one out of many projects into which we have to engage in our generation, I guess, in order to solve and tackle this bigger issue in terms of air. But at the same time, there is also this basic idea that it has to go and extend this very formal discourse of either, you know, being within science or academic or within architecture and just talking about ecology the entire time. But it has to actually be part of a culture in which our idea of like trying to intertwist architecture with aspects of youth culture will lead to the second step of Model Hour today. Yeah, and I think I can basically wrap it up by saying that maybe like one last point. I guess in opposition to anyone who would say not building is better than building, we truly believe that producing pilot projects like Free Air, fusing the idea of a real-time laboratory with questions of contemporary culture, fashion, music, technology, architecture, is really the only way how we hope to design, namely through the idea and fascination of a lifestyle strongly and critically embedded in the now. Thank you. This was a wild ride. I hope, like, you know, these technical difficulties didn't, like, completely mess it up. I'm super happy that you came. Really, really happy about it. Also to Cristina Raúl, it's so cool that you're here. We will now go to the second stage of the presentation. Or not actually of the presentation, but go from the presentation towards a performance, through which I would dearly invite you all to stay here for the next 30 minutes. In which Ines Barreras, director, will work with a couple of performance artists. And you're happy to stay here. We can get into conversations with each other. Thanks for coming and talk to you in a bit.